It's 4 o'clock, and I'd like to call this meeting of the Assembly of Delegates to order and ask that you stand and pledge allegiance to the flag with me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Richard Anderson.
Here.
Ronald Bergstrom.
Here.
Mark Boardman. George Bryant.
Present.
Dennis Fonseca.
Here.
Raymond Gottwall.
Here.
Marcia King.
Here.
Sheila Lyons.
Here.
Thomas Lynch. John Oman.
Here.
Anthony Scalise. Fred Shilp.
Here.
Charlotte Strebel.
Here.
Julia Taylor.
Here.
Madam Speaker, we have a quorum with 68.64% of the delegates present.
Thank you. We can do some business then. approval of the calendar of business. Are there any changes to that? If not, I would ask for a motion to approve.
Madam Speaker, I move approval of the calendar of business.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Approval of the Journal of May 16th, 2007. Are there any additions or corrections to those minutes? Hearing none, I would ask for a motion to approve the journal.
Madam Speaker, move approval of the Journal of May 16th, 2007.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. We'll go to communications from the Board of County Commissioners. We have Chairman Lance Lambros and Vice Chairman Mary LeClaire with us and a representative from AmeriCorps. Thank you for coming.
Mary Schumacher, and we're going to let her go first that she can tell you what she has to say today.
Thank you. Like Mary said, my name is Mary Schumacher. I'm the regional supervisor for the program, and I just came, actually talked to the county commissioners earlier today and thought that I would come here and check in with you all as well. There is going to be a flyer in your packet that includes some special dates that are coming up for the program, and there's one really exciting one that I just wanted to tell you about, and that is we're actually having an alumni weekend this weekend where I think it's approximately 50 alumni, 40 to 50 alumni are actually coming back to the Cape to celebrate the program. And the really big event that's happening is at Coonamesset Farm in Falmouth. We're having a big dinner and would like to invite any and all of you who would be interested in coming and touching base with some of our alumni to find out what AmeriCorps members actually do when they leave the Cape. The other thing that I wanted to announce is that the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program was honored with the Conservationist of the Year Award for the Harwich Conservation Trust. And we had a really nice dinner and ceremony last Sunday. And we got this pewter plate that actually is engraved with the AmeriCorps Cape Cod name on it and the emblem for the Harwich Conservation Trust, as well as all the members received an appreciation award signed by all the trustees and the staff for the Harwich Conservation Trust. So we just wanted to touch base and let you know about some of the exciting things that are happening with the program.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you for coming, and congratulations on behalf of the members of the Assembly on your recognition from the Harwich Conservation Group. That you're all doing a wonderful job, and we're very proud of you, and thank you for coming today.
Mary, where did you say some of them are coming from? Did you say that?
Yes, there's actually folks that are coming all the way from Portland, Oregon, and we have some folks that are sort of more local, but also some that are coming from other places in New England, in Florida. So they're really coming from all over to come back to the Cape to celebrate.
That's wonderful. That is great.
We're very lucky, you know, each time the county commissioners go out to the towns and talk about the services that we provide, one of the things that selectmen are always quick to acknowledge is the services that our AmeriCorps members have given over the years, and we appreciate that. I think we're somewhere up in the 60,000 hours of service, dedicated service given back to the towns, and we appreciate Mary and all the work that she does and the whole group over there. At the county commissioners' meeting today, we continued to talk a little bit about the process for replacing the executive director of the Cape Cod Commission. We do have a committee formed. It will be made up of two Cape Cod commissioners, Mary LeClaire, Mark Selinsky, and Maggie Downey. They will be looking at resumes. We posted an ad last week. It'll run again this week. They'll be taking in resumes. They'll be looking at those. I believe it's going to be a 4 to 6 week process as they examine who will replace the executive director. We did put in John Lippman as acting director upon Margot's departure. So everything, again, is business as usual at the Cape Cod Commission. We don't believe we're going to miss a beat, and things will continue as it should. We also had a very good discussion today with the Human Service Committee of the Assembly of Delegates, talking again about what we should do as human service issues need to be addressed at the county level. We are certainly aware of the regional problems that exist, and as I said, over the past 6 years, somewhere in the area of $8 million has been dedicated to address some of those issues, and we talked about how we can do that in the future. As we know now, surpluses are a thing of the past, and money is getting tighter. We are predicting again another tight year next year. So we have to make some tough decisions on how we deal with not just human service issues, but all the other departments as well. I think we had a pretty successful meeting today, and I believe your human service department will be carrying the ball for a little bit with some input from the county commissioners and some outside folks. So that gives you an update on what we're doing. We continue to work on the strategic plan, looking at all our departments on how we can improve and what we can be doing. We're going to blink our eyes. The summer will be over, and we'll be into the budget season again. So we're trying to kind of dot our I's and cross our T's before we get into the fall. And we expect, we're hoping to end up with, you know, being able to cover our budget on July 1st. So if you have any questions, we'll be glad to answer them.
Are there any questions, John?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have a few. The first one is, as June approaches, so do the arrival of the international students all over the Cape. In my particular instance, it's Orleans and Eastham. And I've been handing them copies of the Flex. And it dawned on me today when I was explaining to them that county government is the one that does this, and that's where I was on my way to today. I went to show them where we get credit for it in this wonderful flyer. If you can find county government in this flyer, I'd be very pleased to see it. I think we should be giving ourselves some credit where we do a great job. These kids arrive from Russia and Bulgaria and all these other Eastern European countries, and they know the routes, they know the cost, they know the times within hours of arrival here, and they're using it every day. So I think we should pat ourselves on the back when possible, and we deserve it because it's a great service to these kids, and that's their lifeline. Mm.
We will, and you know, again, we don't take all the credit for all the different things that we do. A lot of times we're below the radar, and we don't pat ourselves on the back too much, but the Flex route is one of the things that we certainly supported the efforts to, along with you know, Mark Forrest from Congressman Delahunt's office, and Congressman Delahunt getting funds for the National Seashore for those buses. That certainly helped because they took some funds that we didn't need to spend on the Flex route buses. It has been a big success, not just during the busy season, John, but even on the off season. We talked to Bill Daugherty, who serves on the RTA, not as a county commissioner, but from Howich, and you know, he always takes the message that Mary and I, you know, kind of pass on to him, to his board, to say we should beef that up a little bit more. And you know, we appreciate that the Lower Cape Towns kind of stepping up. We're also now pushing him to do, you know, that same thing up in the Upper Cape. So, you know, maybe Falmouth and Mashpee and Sandwich will have the Flex route, or, you know, a way to get into Hyannis. So we understand that, and we'll continue to work on that.
Yeah. And we really need to thank Clay Schofield, because Clay is the one who really,
for sure,
did the legwork on it from the Cape Cod Commission.
And if I may, Madam Speaker, being from Down Cape, I don't know where Coonamesset Farms is. So
We'll be able to email you directions. If you, but Mary's email should be right on that flyer. If not, just call the RDO department, and we will get directions for you. It's a wonderful place. Ron Smolowitz has a wonderful farm there. He does a lot of different things with the county. In fact, and he won an EDC grant a few years back for a wind-powered generator there that he uses for his farm. And it's just a great place to be, and I think it's going to be a wonderful night for our AmeriCorps kids.
It's in Hatchville.
Hatchville?
It's in Hatchville, off of 151. But we can get you real specific instructions.
And lastly, Madam Speaker, if I might, you were telling me that you're taking resumes for the new director of the Cape Cod Commission. How far is the search going? Is it a national search? You didn't mention the scope.
Well, you know, today in the electronic world that we live in, any search is a national search, because you can go on the website for, you know, I've had a lot of calls about that, about people saying, well, you know, what are you doing, a national search, you know, why are you going so far and everything? But in our electronic world, that's just about any job is national, because you can get it through your email, and certainly this is the case here. As far as your different magazines and things like that would carry that advertisement for that job, they're all electronic today. So does that answer that question?
Yeah, thank you, Madam Speaker. Thank you.
Any other questions? Fred?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. In our package, there's also a letter from the town of Truro to Darlene at AmeriCorps about the work that was done in Truro building a trail. And Brenda Boland goes on to say that everyone is amazed at the excellent performance of AmeriCorps workers in such inclement weather. Your organization should be very proud of these young people. They are a pleasure to work with and extremely dedicated and helpful. So.
Appreciate that. They really do a great job.
Any other questions?
Any other questions from George?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I appreciate you bringing in Mr. Pariseau from the Fire Academy. And because I have more information about perchlorate, and I sent some out to Tom Camberry and also to John Klim and George Hoyfelder, had handed out copies of an article in the Chemical and Engineering News that's extremely disturbing about perchlorate. For those of you who are unfamiliar with this, this was a chemical found in the ground underneath the Fire Training Academy, which we apparently own. And we've already appropriated about $250,000 to start the exploration and cleanup of this. And the I would imagine that it's going to cost a lot more than that, having gone through an oil spill in Truro in 1976 near our town well field. Things never get better, they only get worse where any sort of pollution has occurred. The article states in the middle paragraph, the second column, new studies by yet another federal agency, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, are increasing the pressure for the government to limit perchlorate exposure. This research shows that exposure to low levels of perchlorate is widespread throughout the United States and potentially affects the health of tens of millions of women, but not men. The ramifications for children these women conceive could be serious, because the substance can impair development of the brains and nervous systems of fetuses and infants. It goes on to say that 90% of the perchlorate is produced either for the benefit or for the United States agencies, including the National Aeronautic and Space Administration and the military. So we're not alone. But I couldn't believe this when I saw it, because when this problem was first brought up, I think it was the 2nd or 3rd of January, the implication was that perchlorate was still an unknown substance, and insofar as it impacts people. And now we have more information. And I'm concerned not only about this, but what other possible spills that exist on property that is owned by the county. I'm talking about both the large and the small, not only the county farm, which I presume we have the title to still, but even this complex, whether things have been buried in the past or dumped in the past that could potentially affect people. Out of the Fire Training Academy, I do not believe there are any children or women nearby who could be impacted by ingesting this material. But certainly around the county farm, we have a residential area on the west, on the north, and on each side. And I believe it's about 70 acres of land that we control. And of course, we have this with some housing all around it on both sides, on three sides. So I'm still quite perplexed why we weren't told about this spill in August. I understand it was discussed, and Tom Cambereri told me that it was discussed at a meeting in the western part of the state before we even found out about it. And the spouse of one of the members of the assembly was told about it long before we ever heard about it. And I just wonder where we fit into the picture. We should be hearing about anything like this as soon as possible. We waited 4.5 months before we were told about this. Tom Cambereri came in on that first meeting of the assembly. Why you could have, it was an emergency, declared an emergency. We really should have had fifes and drums and trumpets playing when he came in. It was such a dramatic announcement. I mean, that's what it amounted to. I was shocked. So and it's been another, it's 9.5 months since the spill was first found. So here we are.
George, let me just stop you right
let
there.
Let me finish.
Go ahead.
Because here we
you're
are
incorrect in many ways.
Almost a year after this was discovered. Tom said he reported it to the commissioners as soon as he knew about it.
That's correct.
And we knew nothing. We were not told anything about it. So I would like to know if the other assembly members want to know about it, a possible huge embarrassment and cost to the county. Does anyone not want to know about something when it happens? Nobody does not want to know. I want to know when something like this happens. I feel responsible. I think that we have a responsibility to correct things as soon as possible. And since we're supposed to be elected to be part of the process, we should know as soon as possible, not 4.5 months afterwards. If one child was affected by this perchlorate poisoning, and it would seem unlikely given the location, I ask you to imagine what the monetary liability would be of the county and the moral liability of the county. Thank you.
Okay, you are incorrect in so many ways, George, I don't even know where to begin. First of all, perchlorate is not a new substance to Cape Cod. Okay, we've been dealing with it at Otis Air Force Base for the past maybe 9 or 10 years. Tom Cambereri happens to serve with me on the IRP over there and knows this chemical very well. Just by luck, because we've had other problems at our fire academy, we know the topography there probably better than any other piece of land that the county owns. So we were very aware of where the water was running and what would happen. This was not a spill. Perchlorate was not a spill at the Fire Training Academy. Perchlorate came from flares that we used to start our fires. We did not know that there was perchlorate in the flares, or we would not have done that. We did that for years. We don't do that anymore. The day Mr. Cambereri told us what was happening happened to be a Wednesday. That day, we came to the Assembly of Delegates and told you exactly what was happening and did an emergency reserve fund transfer. We asked you for $265,000 to sink a well immediately. Our reaction to this problem was immediate and well thought out. Tom Cambereri is an expert at this. We could not have asked for anybody better to be on board who knows how to take care of this problem. Not only did we do that, but we continued to monitor it daily. we acted quicker than the state wanted us to, and we acted quicker than the federal government reports us to do. We did this perfectly to the T. And that was the exact direction that your executive branch gave to the Cape Cod Commission and Tom Carreri in the cleanup. He did a wonderful job and continues to do a wonderful job. Now, he has come back to us twice and reported exactly what's happened. He has been to the town of Barnstable four times. He has had multiple conversations with the water department, John Clem, and Paul Nizwiski. Everybody in Barnstable is well aware of what's happening. The town of Barnstable has decided which wells to leave open and which wells they will close, because that is what will be affected. We have done everything we can do to stop and clean up what we did. There is nothing else that we can do. We have not put a cap on funds. We have not put a cap on going out and getting other individuals who might be able to help us. So when you say that this is a problem that we knew about for 9 months, when you say this is a spill, when you say that this is something that we held back from you, those are all incorrect. We did this to the T, the day we knew about it. So let there be no mistake known. The day the county commissioners knew about it, we reported it to the Assembly of Delegates. We don't have the obligation to. We have the respect to. And that's why we did it. We asked you to support reserve fund transfers, and you folks did it. And we appreciate that. If you remember correctly, I came back 2 weeks later and said, this is the importance of having reserve funds. We don't know when we're going to run into this. This was not planned. This was not something that we knew about to try to cover up. This was something that happened that we were unaware of. And we do know this chemical very well. And we know how it travels through groundwater. We know how it travels and the best way to catch it. And we have done the best we can to contain it. And by the way, if Tom was here, he would say we've been very successful to date doing that.
And I might add that you can go to the website of the Cape Cod Commission and you can follow what is happening every single day on it. So on this, there's up-to-date information on the progress.
You better check your diary, because Tom said that it was discovered at the end of August, and it was reported to you then. He came in here in the first meeting in January, so what you're saying doesn't match what Mr. Camberari said. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Lance, I think there may have been some miscommunication in regards to when Tom first was aware of something, and then when they actually, I think there was a period of time when something happened, but he wasn't sure of exactly what was involved.
Call Tom Camberari, have him come right over. Please. Yeah. You know,
let's not argue the point at this time, because we'll get Tom over here and have him explain it. So, are there any other questions for the commissioners at this time? Sheila?
On a different and a lighter note in some ways, I just wanted to report while we have the commissioners here that over the weekend I attended the housing crisis seminar at Wellfleet that was being held in Wellfleet, headed by John Ryan through the Cape Cod Commission. And, you know, again, saying things that we don't get credit for here in the Cape Cod Commission is under the umbrella. It was really a very informative. It was a four-hour meeting, and I had attended several other. There was a lot going on in Wellfleet about housing and affordable housing, which I think we should really call community housing, because I think people from out of state tend to think of public housing, which is subsidized housing, or, you know, gee, that's not something I want. And they were telling, there were many people there that were involved in affordable housing projects, four of them in Wellfleet, and those projects ended up resulting with two Shellman's families, a banking family, a person who worked at the bank, and another woman who I think was a teacher. Those are the people who moved into those, who were able to purchase those units that were built. But John did an excellent job of taking a lot of information that he had gathered. And sort of pulling it together to where the conversation and the ideas that flowed on trying to educate the public about this really came together in a great way. So I just wanted to give him, I know he's coming to the end of his contract, and he, from what I could see, what he did with Wellfleet, he did a great job. And again, it's information trying to pull the community together under an issue and how to resolve it. And even those who sort of are aware of this problem, of course, everyone who was at this seminar had a house, had housing, but they appreciated the situation, and a lot of them were business owners and that sort of thing. So it was a very informative and worthwhile endeavor, and I think very creative ideas came out of it. So I just wanted to report that back to you and say it was really a great thing. So
appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. Any other questions for the commissioners? Yes.
Well,
I'm not going to hold up the process waiting for Tom. Yeah. If you have questions for the commissioners, we'll ask them and answer them. And if, yes, Fred.
Yes, on a different note. I was really surprised, not shocked, about the announcement that Margo was resigning. And I assume that there will be some kind of party or something where we'll have an opportunity to say goodbye to her, and also to tell her what a terrific job she did as the director of the Cape Cod Commission. Is there any plan, Lance?
I don't think there's any plan yet, but I think on a personal note, Bill and Mary and I have thanked her for her service, and certainly, you know, we'll be attending anything that there is. But we the county has not set any plan for that. I believe there will be something, though.
Yeah.
If she's
going to do 2 months. She's going to be with us for 2 more months.
Yeah. It is my understanding she's coming before the assembly on the 18th of July, mm-hmm. which is her last day. So we will have an opportunity at that time to individually and as a unit express our appreciation to her for what she has done for the county through the Cape Cod Commission. But she will be here, and it will be her last day. Okay.
Thank you
very much for
Thank
coming.
You.
And as soon as Tom comes in, we'll have him. But I am going to move forward with the Fire Academy. I have taken the action that I feel that it is essential for the members of the assembly. We have 5 new members, and many do not know what the county departments do. And so with the help of Diane, we are contacting all of the department heads, and we're asking them to come in and give us a presentation on what their departments do. It will be new for the new members, and it will be old but updating other members. So I am beginning today with the director of the Barnstable County Fire Academy, Lee Pariseau. So Lee, thank you very much for coming here today.
You're welcome.
Am I on? Can you hear me?
You're on.
Yep.
Okay. My name is Lee Pariseau, and I am the director of the Fire Training Academy, as most of you know. Coming under the gun here a little bit lately, but what we're here for today is to give you an idea of just what we do and what we don't do, maybe, but more importantly, what we do, the kind of things we do, the kind of training we do. And I brought a couple of my staff members along with me. They're program coordinators. To my immediate left is Dennis Macedo, and to his left is Steve Hoffman. Excuse me. What they do is run the whole show. I sit back and let them do everything and have a good time, sort of. Without people like this and a few of my other program coordinators, we wouldn't accomplish what we do in a year. And I think when you see the end of this little short program, you'll see that we accomplish an awful lot in a given fiscal year. For the county and for other agencies, too. So what I'll do is I'll turn this over to Dennis first, and he'll go through about half of it. Steve will go through the other half of it, and then I will be the guy to sit here and answer questions. There is a short video, and I'll tell you ahead of time, there is another video at the end of the program if we have enough time. If you'd like to see it, it's one that our deputy director, Mark Foley, produced I think around 2002 possibly, that received a Mother Against Drunk Driving National Award on its merit for helping people to understand what happens in drunk driving, especially teenagers. This was done in conjunction with the Yarmouth Fire Department. So if you choose to see that when you can, but right now I'll turn it over so we can get going here.
Okay, fine. Thank you, Lee.
Thanks, Lee. As Lee said, my name is Dennis Macedo. I have been in the fire service 23 years, and I am a program coordinator over at the Academy. What I'd like to do is just maybe start out from where the Academy started back in 1959, and kind of bring you up to speed to where we're at today. And I'm going to hand it off to Steve, and he'll finish it up. Our Academy started... There you go, man. We'll start out with the apparatus. Over the years, we have purchased a couple of apparatus. Originally, we had a pumper that's up on the top left that the county purchased as one of our original apparatus, and most recently, a ladder truck within the last year, as well as the trailer. All of the apparatus and vehicles that we have at the Fire Academy have been donated either by Cape Cod departments or departments such as the one I belong to, the city of New Bedford, which is the yellow pumper that you see in the picture. We have also received generous donations, and I must say a special thanks to Shepley Lumber. They have been a huge help to us in supplying materials whenever we've needed them to build props and to keep our props up to date and modern as possible. Just a slight overview of what our property looks like and where some of the props are located on the facility. And some of the props you see. That building in the top left was built with donations from Shepley Lumber. That entire building was donated by them and built by our staff at the Academy. Up in the top right is a maritime prop that's currently under construction, as well as a rope tower down in the bottom right. And currently we are erecting a shelter to house the apparatus that we've been donated. I also must thank the staff at the Academy. Not only do we tap them for their expertise in fire service, but we also utilize them above and beyond what we probably should for their expertise as carpenters, electricians, welders, and we put them to work erecting these props that we would not be able to afford any other way. Opening day in 1959, the Academy was put together by the Cape and Island Drill Masters and the Chiefs Association from Barnstable County, volunteer agencies, and it started with a mission to give back to the county fire departments and to train the county fire departments. This is what the property looked like in 1959, kind of desert-like, not very much on it. Some of the programs that went on in 1964, a burn building was built. We had some automobile fires as well as flammable liquid fires. And again in 1960, a little before my time in the fire service. The building as it was in 1964 in the top left and how it looks today, the structure on the right on the bottom picture is actually the newer part of the building. Over the years, we have not reached out to the Cape Cod Fire Department, which is our main goal, but fire departments all over the U.S. and Canada. Most recently, I received an email from a friend up in Canada that we had trained repeatedly down here in Barnstable. They had a serious incident where they almost lost a couple of firefighters. A couple of firefighters were seriously injured. And the email went on to state that if it had not been for the training they received here in Barnstable, that they very well may have lost a couple of lives in that fire. That was a good pat on the back for us. Some of the programs we offer as far as firefighting, structural fire attack, fire ground search, ladder company operations, there's dozens of them. Some of the main ones are rapid intervention. This is where we take a firefighter, a seasoned firefighter, we take him through self-survival and preservation techniques during critical incidents that happen in the fire service, unpredictable incidents, right through how to save other firefighters when they become victims of a fire themselves. We also do flashover programs, which teaches a firefighter how to recognize flashovers and backdraft situations in a controlled environment, something that you could not possibly expect to see in a real situation. By the time you realize what is happening to you in a flashover or backdraft, it's too late. So we try to bring this to our firefighters in a controlled environment so they can see the warning signs prior to them happening. Modern technology thermal images that have come from the military are now in the fire service, and we try to perfect the firefighter skills using this equipment. We also run technical rescue programs at the academy, such as confined space, trench rescue, structural collapse, things that are normally not seen by most firefighters in their career, but happen very rarely, and probably need to be trained more thoroughly than we do in the fire service. We get a lot more practice fighting fires than we do with these technical rescue programs. And these are some of the props, again, that we have built, or the staff has built at the academy. Confined space props on the left, rope towers, as well as using outside facilities to do our rope training, to trench rescue that we run on the property. We also do vehicle and machinery excavation, and a new program that we did this year, and it was held down in the Lower Cape, was cold water rescue programs. And I'm going to turn it over to Steve. Thank you.
Hi, Steve Hoffman. Been in the fire service for about 19 years, been at the academy for 8. Some of the other programs we do is we do a hazmat program. We teach our recruit firefighters hazmat, but also we go out to the different communities, different towns across the Cape. This summer or in the fall, we'll probably be in Mashpee doing a program, and it keeps firefighters up to date on hazardous materials that are being transported across the borders and lets them know how to respond to these and how to protect themselves from them. One of our big programs we offer it every fall now. It's a 12-week program, 2 nights a week, and every Saturday is our Firefighter 1 and 2 program. That's where we see a lot of people from across the Cape, and we teach firefighters their basic skills. People coming in off the street have never known what a firefighter does. They come in, we train them over the 12 weeks, and when they graduate, they become certified as firefighters within the state of Massachusetts. We also provide professional development. So we take the recruit firefighters to start off, and then as they get into their careers, we start to do some professional development for them. We teach them how to teach. Kind of what we do at the academy is we teach them how to instruct programs with our Instructor 1 program. Our Instructor 2 program is generally for our staff, is we teach people how to write programs, how to take a program, put it all together, and hand it to somebody to go, here, you can teach this now. And we also teach a Fire Officer 1 program for people to be promoted throughout the fire service. It gives them a little idea, gives them a better understanding of what to expect when they become a leader within the fire service. The incident command system is something that has taken off in the past year and a half to 2 years. It's been about 2 years now. It was 2 years ago this summer that the federal government has mandated all towns, cities, and everything else, anyone that would like federal funding after a disaster or for anything else, that they have to have a certain level of incident command system training. And we've trained, I believe it's about 1,500 people across the Cape in the past 2 years to certain levels of this incident command system training. Not just firefighters, we're talking DPW people, town administrators, the whole gambit throughout the town. One thing that we just received, the ICS 300, which is now the intermediate, and we're getting into the 400 level, the advanced level. We just got approval from the state to start doing those. The state is controlling those a little more. We just posted our first offering today for that program through MEMA. And MEMA is actually helping us out. We're doing it in conjunction with MEMA for the Cape. We do industrial programs. We do train the Pilgrim Nuclear Power Plant Station, their fire brigade. They come down and do 8 weeks of training in the fall so they can handle emergencies on their site. Some of the other programs we used to do a couple of the other atomic energy plants across New England, and we also used to do an extinguisher program for some of the other power plants. We've done the power plant in Sandwich. Some of the other programs we have done is like Sandwich Marine. They come and do extinguisher training that they need to have for their employees. So we're providing these services that stuff they need to have done, we do it for them. We also do a maritime program, teaching people who are on ships to maintain their qualifications. They have to have a certain level of firefighter training. We do a basic marine program, which is a two-day class, and we do an advanced marine firefighting program, which is 3 days on top of the initial two. And this fall, one of our new programs that we're offering under our maritime is shipboard firefighting for land-based firefighters. We have a lot more shipping coming through off the Cape lately, so we're teaching firefighters who, like myself, who are based on land, is that if there's an emergency on a boat, how do you handle it? What do you do? That's a new program we'll be offering this fall. This year, we offered Citizens Fire Academy about, I think it was about 7 years ago. We offered one, we got a lot good response. The second one we tried to offer, we didn't get as much response, so we brought it back this year. We got about 14 people to sign up for it. And what this does is it goes through and teaches people, just the lay people in the community, what your local fire department does. And we get them in, we've got them in turnout gear there, they climb ladders, we put them on ropes and load them off of a building. So we showed them all the different aspects of firefighting, and that was a 7 weeks. It was one night a week and then a Saturday that we did all the practical work in. And one of our big things that we do is department burns. Departments come, book our building. We provide some staff for them. They come in and train themselves. So they practice, I think Bourne is coming next week. They're coming in to do some training for some new people. They bring them in. They're allowed to use our facility under our direction. And we do a lot of these each year because departments like to come in and practice with their own people, not just come to a class where it's all different people. They want to get used to working together. And this is a big part of our facility, is letting departments come in and use it. If you look at this, between fiscal year 2005 and fiscal year 2006, this is just an overview of the services we provided total. I have the next slide breaks it down between county fire departments and county agencies and other agencies, but it was almost $350,000 in fiscal year 06 is the services we provided. That's not money we took in specifically, because we have to kind of put a figure on. We don't charge Cape people, so we kind of put a figure on it, which what we would charge outside people to come in and take the class. And that's the figure that we came up with for fiscal year 2006 of the services we provided total. And then this one is for Cape Fire Departments, it was about $234,000. That was just to the Cape Fire Departments. That was the amount of services we provided that they paid us zero for. Other Cape agencies, if you look, there was a major jump there. That was the incident command system training. That was a big part of that, was a lot of agencies needed it. And that was $66,400 in fiscal year 2006. And off-Cape agencies, they were generating revenue for the academy, but we also have to figure in there that these were services we provided too, and it stayed just about the same. So that was about level. This is about a 3.5-minute video of our recruit program. What we do for them is do a video at the end of their program and show it at their graduation. Thank you.
gentlemen, that's the end of our little presentation here, minus the other video.
I think that I'm going to ask you to hold that other video, Lee, because our videographer's got another date, and so we're going to have to move along. But I do want to make arrangements with you to have the entire assembly members come out to the Fire Academy on a Wednesday prior to our meeting, and for a demonstration of what we have seen here, and then maybe at that time we could also see the video that Mark made that received that recognition, because I have seen it, and I think that it's well worth other people seeing. But I'll open it up for questions. If there are any questions that members of the assembly would like to ask Lee or Dennis or Steve, are there any questions? John?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I have a few. Maybe it was me. It seems to me that most of the use of the fire departments day in and day out is rescue, EMT. Do you do a lot of that training? I didn't notice it in all of the other things.
We do none of that. Well, no. The programs that we run have recertification points awarded by emergency medical system services from the state, so they get requalification or recertification points for those classes that they take. What is going on is the Cape and Islands Emergency Medical Services System is using that back building, which is where the sheriff used to have his training office, and they are running paramedic and EMT refresher classes back there using that classroom. We are augmenting at times some of their staff with our staff to teach some of their programs. So yes, we are moving a little bit into emergency medical services, but our programs have always had some recertification points with them.
It just seems to me, I'm again, as a non-professional thing, that's what most of the fire department's use of their time is EMT and rescue, especially with our, including myself, aging population.
Would that not tell you that they are probably very proficient at doing, emergency medical services, and they're probably not as efficient at handling fire scenarios? Training in fire scenarios, it gives them the opportunity to learn what us old folks used to learn when we had 3 or 4 fires a day or a week when I first came on. We need to continue doing that, and we've done that for a long time, and I'm going to blow the hat for the county here, the horn for the county here a little bit, and your fire service in Cape Cod, and because of the unique system we have here in training our firefighters, you have the best trained firefighters in the state of Massachusetts. Working right here in Cape Cod, because they're continually requalifying, relearning old tricks, and learning new tricks all the time. They're always up to date.
Is that it?
I've got a laundry list, but I'll just ask one more and defer to my fellow delegates. I noticed over the years that, you know, many of the towns use your services quite a bit, but there are some really gaps of certain fire departments. It's Falmouth, I think, hardly ever uses your services. How can they possibly afford not to use them? Is there politics to it that I don't understand?
If I knew the whole answer to that, I'd love to be able to answer that. The answer is we offer it to them. We have started getting some of the Falmouth people to come. I believe there's a political thing there, and I'm not really sure what it is. They are a civil service department, as where most of the other departments on the Cape aren't. I don't have an answer for you. I don't know why they're so lax in using us.
Their loss. Are there any other questions, Sheila?
It's not a question. I just wanted to make a comment. I'm from Wellfleet, and Danny Silverman has sought me out actively throughout the budget process, and was always on the ready, and always telling me how important the Fire Academy was. So I just wanted to give him credit for that. But I also think that, you know, firemen, you know, put their life on the line, whether it's once a year or once a week. So thanks for that. But I just wanted to let you know that he's a great lobbyist and advocate for the fire department there. So
thank you, Sheila. Any other questions or statements anyone would like to make? Would you like to make another one, John?
Well, as I said, Madam Speaker, I have a laundry list, but I wanted to defer to my other delegates. There's a couple of things, too. Is you said that you delineate cost structure on all 15 Cape Towns. So at the Bourne line, anybody beyond the Bourne line pays for their services, and all 15 towns on this side. Is that the only delineation, the 15 towns? Anybody on this side of those 15 towns from Bourne to P-Town does not pay? Is that as simple as that?
As simple as that, including Otis. We consider Otis because they use us very little, and they're a mutual aid. They mutual aid to all the surrounding communities. That it's only we believe that it's only fair that they should be allowed to take our training. You know, two or three of them once or twice a year is not a budget breaking item for us. So that's pretty much where it is. Yes.
And if I may continue, just this may not be directly in your purview, but it's something that's been on my mind, and I'm always looking for professional responses to these particular things. I know that every town in Cape Cod is hurting for budgets, every one of them. And it seems to me that well-placed equipment could be that seldom used could be shared between towns effectively. Do you have an opinion on that, number one? And number two, do you have an opinion how we could convince some of the fire departments to use county dispatch to save their town's money as well? I know, like I said, this is not your job, but you are in the profession, all three of you, and I thought that you may offer some enlightenment to us county legislatures. Thank you.
Again, you may be asking me to commit political suicide, but you're talking about regionalization of agencies, if you will, and my belief is that, my personal belief has nothing to do with the county, with the fire service, or anybody else, that regionalization makes sense. It makes more sense in some place than others. It makes sense for cost saving, for manpower saving, for equipment saving, for all, you know, right down the line, it makes sense. If it can work, I believe that the initial startup of an agreement between communities to do that is initially going to be very expensive. Over a long period of time, I believe that it would level out and that the funding would be at least a known factor most of the time and maybe not quite so many unknowns.
But frankly, you do it now with personnel, with manpower. You cover each other as mm-hmm. and shift manpower. Mm-hmm. Why can't equipment? I mean, I'm just looking at out for not just my particular town, but every town in Cape Cod. There's a lot of money involved, and the people don't. We don't have it anymore. No town has it. And I just thought it was just something that. And you're the conduit for all 15 towns and Otis as well. You know, I just wonder if there's any way we can move forward and try to accomplish real money savings for these towns and still provide the best of services. So the equipment follows the manpower shift.
Mm-hmm. I want to thank you and Dennis and Steve for coming here today and making this presentation, answering the questions that we have. And as I said before, I'd like to have Diane make a date for us to come over to the Academy and spend some time there and look around and see in actuality what we saw on the film. And so thank you again for coming. You're doing a wonderful job. And I know that all of the towns appreciate what you're doing. And I thank you again for coming.
You're welcome. And we'll be more than happy to schedule a date at any time.
Wonderful.
As long as I'm not fishing.
Yeah, okay. All right, well, make sure that it isn't a fishing day. Thank you again. Tom, I see you have arrived. I'm sorry that I had to make you wait, but would you mind coming forward and responding to the questions and statements that Delegate Bryant has made regarding the perchlorate at the Fire Academy?
As I understand the, am I on?
If the light is green, you are on.
As I understand the...
Now push it again, Tom.
Okay, now it's really on. As I understand the issue, Madam Chairman, it has to do with when we knew we had issues and notifications. And we did our initial testing on well out at the facility back in August, and that when we got our results, we were aware that we had an exceedance of a brand new MCL. There was no maximum contaminant limit for perchlorate until July of 06. So in August, we had a sample from a monitoring well, and that exceeded that new limit. And according to the Massachusetts contingency regulations, we followed those to a T, notifying DEP, the town, the water division, and working through the executive branch with Mark Zielinski, we began a path of trying to delineate, say, how you know, how extensive was this? We had really no idea. We had one exceedance in a monitoring well, and it wasn't until we were mobilized, did the paperwork for the DEP, in this case, it was the regulating authority for these issues, that we had an idea of just how extensive the issue was at the end of December. And it wasn't until we had cost estimates and went to the county commissioners that we had a full knowledge of what the extent was. And on that day, when we went to the county commissioners with the cost estimates and how extensive it was, that was the same afternoon that we came to share that information with the Assembly of Delegates. So there was a period of time when I would say staff and executive branch were working on this issue, and I think you know, following the lead of the town of Barnstable and the water division, we were working you know, with them to evaluate how extensive the issue was. And you know, I take a lead from George Hoyfelder on these issues when he has a sample from wells and public water supplies that could be of a concern. He treads very carefully with that information to get a fuller, better idea of the extent, to see, you know, how serious it is. Certainly, if public health was an imminent threat, that information would need to go where it would go. But not knowing and needing to do assessment on that, need to be very careful about this information.
Fine, thank you. George, did that answer your questions?
Yes.
Thank you, Tom. I couldn't hear most of what you said. My age is being fixed. The 21st of February, you came in here and talked to us at the meeting. And at that time, I asked you when the problem was discovered. And you said that it was the 25th of August. I made a note in my diary about it.
That was on my PowerPoint presentation.
Speak up, please.
That date was on my PowerPoint presentation.
Yeah. And I looked at Tom, who was sitting next to me, and he looked at me and he said, "That's interesting. I think, should have known earlier. I know it's not your decision to make. You work for the, essentially work for the commissioners. But we should have been informed in some way, if it had to be a big secret, if it had to be something that had to be delivered by some kind of special mail, I would understand it. But we're responsible people. And when I read this in the Chemical Engineering News, and I sent you a copy, did you get a copy of this?
Yes, I did, just recently.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. When I read this article, I was surprised. And, of course, it's near a public water supply. There are no women with children living in the area that was affected by this. But it's a public. There's a public water supply nearby.
Yeah, I would also say, George, that in that February appearance that I made, I was giving an update on the whole status of the issues. But the county commissioners, you know, did come in and early, if not at the end of December, was like the first time in January to say that, you know,
I've always been very supportive of your work, and I'm very happy that you've been here for so many years. But you said that it was discussed at a meeting out in the western part of the state before we even heard about it. Isn't that correct? The spouse of one of the people on the assembly knew about it before any of the rest of us did.
I can't say what the channels of communication should be on those issues. As a technical person evaluating this for the county, I was working with the executive branch, and I guess it was up to that branch to figure out how it wanted to communicate the issue.
When we talk about brain damaged babies, we're talking about something that's, I think, serious. So, anyway, a spouse of one of the assembly members knew about it before we did.
George, I don't want to cut this conversation short, but I think we've beaten the horse to death. I think, Tom, thank you for coming. We're not going to solve the problem, George. I mean, if somebody knew before Tom knew, they should have shared the information with us. If a spouse of somebody on the assembly knew about it, perhaps it might have fallen on their shoulders to say, did you all know something was happening at the Fire Training Academy? And so I think that I appreciate your coming over, Tom. I see one hand. I'm on a time constraint, so... And we've got an ordinance, so.
Okay, I happen to be the spouse, and to see what happened is that after we got that information, I mentioned it to my wife, and she said yes, the subject was brought up at this convention, and so on, and the problem had gone back, and the information had gained currency among certain people, but the purpose of the conference was basically to brainstorm this stuff, so it may have been part of the process of assessing the damage before that. But my only question to Tom is there's reporting requirements to DEP. Is that public? I mean, once you report that, I mean, is that public information that could be available to someone who wanted to seek it out?
Yes, and any of those forms and that would be public information. And again, there's a requirements, you know, to report to DEP, the municipal officer, the public health officers, and the water division as well.
All right. So my only comment is that I understand why you'd want to be discreet about this information, but if you run the risk, if you give out information that becomes public, if someone should want it and find out, and then it gets to us through a back channel, you know, it creates an embarrassing situation. I mean, I don't think any damage was done. I don't know if we would have run out there with shovels or something, but I think it probably could have been handled better. So I agree with George.
And I would just say, Madam Chair, that the system is being put through its paces right now. Mm-hmm. The system that the ordinance paid for, we hope to have it up and running 24/7 tomorrow. And I also, I think the team that we put together did a great job on that. Also, I'd like to thank Lee Pariseau and his team for being assistants to put that together. I think their work and pitching in saved the county, you know, over you know, $10,000 or more. And I also would invite the assembly, when they come to visit the training facility, to take a look at the new treatment center as well.
Yes, thank you very much. Lance, did you have a...
Yeah, I just want to, again, reiterate the implication that, you know, the county commissioners knew anything about this earlier and kept this under the hat, or for some reason or any reason, you know, kept this in our pocket, is just absolutely false. Everybody should be fully aware that when Mark made it, available, that information available to us, we acted appropriately and timely, as we always will. And that's not something out of, as I said, an obligation to the assembly. It's something out of respect that we do to the assembly. There's no chain that says we have to do that. We give you the common courtesy to do that, and we will continue to do that in the future.
Thank you, Lance. Thank you, Tom, for coming over. And at this point, I'm going to convene the assembly and go to item number 11 on the calendar of business, which is proposed ordinance 0705 to add to the county's operating budget for fiscal year 2007 by making a supplemental appropriation for the purpose of funding electricity costs. I understand that there was a committee meeting this afternoon at 3:30. Is there a report from Finance Committee on this, Marcia? Or, I'm sorry. Well, Tom's not here.
Madam Chairman.
Oh. Thank you, Fred.
As the
I didn't know who was
Chair of the
make it.
Public Service
Thank you.
Committee, there was a joint meeting of Finance and Public Service to consider the ordinance. There was a quorum of both. Marcia acted on behalf of both the Public Service and Finance Committee for that vote. And there's a report in front of me. It's amazing. so that at 3:30, we or actually about 10 of 4, or quarter of 4, when we had enough people, we met and considered it, and transferring the money from reserve accounts to fund electricity for two areas of facilities, and we voted unanimously to do that.
And you are submitting that ordinance?
And I am submitting ordinance 0705 to the Assembly of Delegates.
Just one moment, please, if I may ask. There's two parts to this. There's one part for $5,166.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And then there's a second part for $15,834. It's all on the same ordinance, but I think you need to. Yeah.
If I may, Madam
please.
Speaker, in order to cover the electricity costs, the funds are coming from two different areas. So
right.
Section one is a transfer of funds, and that it's a transfer of funds that have already been appropriated, and section two is an appropriation.
Okay.
And
right.
So that's why you have two sections, but it's all for the same purpose.
All for the same purpose, okay. So you are making the motion.
I'm making a motion for both of them. Should
okay.
I do it one after the other?
A second to the motion? Thank you. Any questions regarding this ordinance? Seeing none, since it involves money, I will ask the clerk to call the roll.
Richard Anderson?
Yes.
Ronald Bergstrom?
Yes.
Mark Boardman?
Yes.
George Bryant?
Yes.
Dennis Fonseca?
Yes.
Raymond Gottwald?
Yes.
Marcia King?
Yes.
Sheila Lyons?
Yes.
John Oman?
Yes.
Fred Schilt?
Yes.
Charlotte Strebel?
Yes.
Julia Taylor?
Yes.
Madam Speaker, proposed ordinance 07-05 passes with 71.49% of the delegates voting present.
Fine. Thank you very much.
Voting yes. Excuse me.
Thank you.
Pardon me.
Reports from committees. Are there any? Ray?
I wanted to brief some of the delegates about the meeting that the Health and Human Services Committee had with the county commissioners today. And George was there and Ron was there, the three county commissioners and several members of the Human Services Advisory Council, just to discuss the whole process of funding human service programs in the county, you know, in terms of the future. I don't think anybody felt it worked that well. There was obviously a lot of pull and tug and tension, and I think people have different visions about what a county service is. So there was talk about forming a blue ribbon committee, but then we kind of decided to make it a smaller group, so it's going to consist of the Assembly Human Services Committee, the county commissioners, the co-chairs of the Human Service Advisory Council, and Len Stewart. And we're going to be meeting Wednesday, June 20th at 2. But it was a very honest and frank discussion. I think people got several points across. And one being that the size of our budget being $24 million, which I think is about the size of Orleans, and Barnstable being $146 million, who don't even have a human service program or give out any human service grants, that, again, we have to be realistic, in my opinion, of what the county, you know, can afford or cannot afford. So, and Ron can add to that, and George. So, but we'll be meeting here June 20th at 2.
Okay.
Meeting here?
Yes.
Assembly?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Our questions? Yes, George?
I'd just like to add to that that Len has a two pages of printouts of the contributions of the towns to human services, and he's going to send it to me, and I will copy it for everyone, so we'll know what sort of weight the towns have been pulling. But it's for 2005.
Yeah,
so we'll have a better idea. Maybe some of you do have a feeling for it, but I think everybody should know. Thank you.
I have seen that report, and it really, it's 2 years late. I don't know if there have been any changes, but it will at least give everybody an idea of what is going on as far as human services. Fred, did you have a question? No. Okay. Any other questions? Let's see. Any other committee reports? No. Okay. Report from the clerk.
I don't have any report today. Thank you.
Okay.
Darn.
Yeah.
I do that. I just want to mention that I did get a call from Eastham. I think I reported on this a few weeks ago, and they were concerned that they didn't have enough time to fulfill their obligation to fill the seat and ask for more time. And we did get a letter back thanking for the extended time period, and they intend to have somebody named to the Eastham vacancy position by June 20th. So anyway, we should have someone here at the next meeting.
Good. Okay. One other question that we did have was in regards to the towns about the review the commission.
Okay.
Can you update us on that?
In trying to determine, I'll back up. Because of our tight budget next year, we're trying to make sure that everything that takes place going forward is as tight as possible, because there's absolutely no waste in our budget whatsoever, and we want to make sure that every penny is used as needed. And so I have a question. We supply, as part of our videography services, we supply DVDs or tapes to various towns, and the public access towns, and also then the towns that have the government channels. And right now there are 9 either tapes or DVDs that we pay for and have them be delivered. And my question is, do you, in your respective towns, see the assembly on TV, or do you get feedback that people see these tapes? We're trying to determine whether or not it's a cost that is effective, that should go forward, or are they, I know in Falmouth, I do hear comments that people do see it, and it's aired pretty regularly, so... I guess I would like feedback from each of your towns to know whether or not, if we're providing a tape, and I'll read to you if you like where they're going. Will that help? They're going to Barnstable Town Hall, Chatham Town Hall, Dennis Town Hall. This is all for Channel 18, Harwich Community Center, and Yarmouth Town Hall. That's all the community... what is it called? Government channels. The government channels. And then we provide a DVD to Bourne, what was formerly Adelphia, obviously now Comcast, Falmouth Community TV Channel 13, Mashpee Public Access Channel 20, Sandwich Public Access Channel 64, C3 TV, and that, which is in Yarmouth, and Lower Cape Channel 17, which is in Orleans. So if you have any guidance of whether or not there's value to or not value to any of these locations, it would be really helpful.
Fred?
I have never seen the Assembly on television for some reason. I've never seen it. But I do hear from people in Truro that they have seen it.
Okay.
And some of them say they watch it all the time. I don't quite understand that, but
and would they get through that through the Harwich?
They get it through the Orleans.
Through the Orleans.
I think Orleans serves Channel 17 on our part of the Cape.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Sheila?
I just want to reiterate that I've had people come up to me and talk to me about the meetings and what was going on.
Okay,
and
so Wellfleet.
Through Orleans? That would be through Orleans as well?
Is that through Orleans, Sheila?
Yes, that's the Channel 17.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I get mine. I see mine on
C3 TV.
Out of Yarmouth.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
C3 TV, okay.
Yeah. Okay.
It covers Harwich, Chatham, and Dennis, and Yarmouth.
Ron?
Yeah, I have never seen an Assembly meeting on Channel 18, and I don't know why, because we have a person who basically does all our video right in-house. And
do you get any feedback from people?
No, I have never heard anybody bring up an Assembly meeting, and maybe there's some lack of communication, but I think I would honestly want to have them on there so they wouldn't run these interminable reruns of the selectmen's meetings. You know, so anything besides that, so maybe I'll discuss it and find out why we don't get it.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you. Yeah. If you could check and find out if they are running it and if they want it, okay?
Is this something you could check on tomorrow, Ron?
And I could find out, yeah, tomorrow.
And I'll call you later in the day or Friday morning.
Thank you. Dick.
Madam Speaker, as Bourne's delegate and as the guy that puts it on the air in Bourne, I get complaints if I don't put it on the air in Bourne. So.
Good. Thank you.
Okay.
John, do you?
Yeah, I must say that I get a lot of comments anecdotally in the town that they see it often.
Okay. All right.
You're getting it to Channel 18, Dennis Town.
17.
Yeah. Julia, do you have any comments?
People do mention it.
Yeah, okay.
My students. Oh, I saw you on TV, Mrs. Taylor.
Yeah. George, do you get any feedback at all? Okay. All right. Okay.
Can I back up for a minute?
Yeah,
just
sorry.
A second. Because we have two Yarmouth stations.
No.
Wait a minute. We have two. Who just said? Oh, John just said you get it through Channel 17.
Right, same as me.
Yeah.
So you're seeing it through the Lower Cape?
Yeah, the Lower Cape.
No, that's mid-cape. The Mid Cape channel. Yeah. C3 TV now is Channel 17.
Yeah. It's Channel 17.
Oh,
so
you're.
It's the Mid Cape.
It was called the Lower Cape.
Well, I'm wondering if you get it through your town hall.
No.
See, it comes.
I've not seen it through the
on the
channel
government
18.
Channel. You don't see it.
I've not seen it, but I'll ask at town hall.
Because Yarmouth comes through the government channel.
Well, that must be duplication as well, because you get Channel 17.
Yeah, that's what I'm concerned about,
yeah.
So I've got to check it out.
Okay.
Okay. Anybody else got any comments?
Dennis?
Yes, they do show it in Sandwich. As a matter of fact, the police department shows it to prisoners as a behavior modification technique. Thank you.
Didn't that violate the Geneva Convention?
Okay.
I know.
Mashpee?
Yeah.
Yes, double local.
Okay. All right, and Orleans?
Orleans, yes.
Okay, all right.
And then I'm approached most by people from Orleans, whom I know. They seem to watch it intensively there, and they're very familiar with what's going on. The most surprising thing happened a couple of years ago when
can I hold you to that for just a minute, because I want to get through this, because we're going to lose what we're getting. Yeah.
I'm wondering, we may have some duplications going to the public, the governmental mm-hmm. channels through the.
We'll do some checking.
It's all been a great help.
All right. I have several things that I just want to bring up. You were given, and it's my fault that you're late in getting it, a report, the report from the county commissioners on the 21st Century Task Force report was faxed over. I have the originals, was going to bring it today, and came off without it. But this is a letter that was addressed to me as Speaker of the Assembly and to Brad Kroll as the Chairman of the Cape Cod Commission. This is from the county commissioners, and it is their report on the 21st Century report that you got information on. I wanted you to have this so that you could see how it's going to be handled through the county, through the Cape Cod Commission. And I also wanted you to have it in your possession, because when Margot Fenn comes on the 18th of July, she is going to be talking about this as to what has been done up to her departure, and the timetable for what hasn't been accomplished. So read it through. It's very interesting if you have the original report to see. I think everything that was in those reports is in here. I worked with the county commissioners putting this together. We had all the information, and I think it sounds good. You'll see in here that the assembly is going to be held accountable to make sure that a great deal of this legislation is accomplished and done the way it's supposed to be done. There's not going to be any more rubber stamping of things when they come in with something. One of the changes in here is the regional policy plan. If something comes forth from the regional policy plan, it's going to be changed immediately. It is not going to be put in a file and changed 5 years when the next regional policy plan is reviewed. It is going to be, an ordinance is going to be written, and it's going to come before us, and we'll have to have public hearings on it, but it's going to be changed immediately. So you'll see the changes in here. I hope that you'll read it. Bring it with you when Margot comes. The other thing that I wanted to ask you, we have one more meeting in June, which is the 20th, and at that time we're going to have a presentation from the Cape Light Compact. Our next meeting falls on the 4th of July, which is the first Wednesday in the month of July. My question to you is, this is kind of a quiet time where we're out of the budget session and we haven't gotten into the next one yet, and things are kind of quiet. Would you be interested in not having a meeting, two meetings, I should say, in the month of July, and foregoing? We could have one on the 11th if you felt that it was necessary, or we can skip that and go directly to the second meeting in July, which is July 18th. So I would ask you if you have any thoughts about skipping the 4th of July and just having one meeting in the month. John?
Madam Speaker, I would love to skip the first monthly meeting in July, personally speaking, from my business point of view. But is there anything written into the legislation to address the fact that occasionally the first and third Wednesday of the month might be a national holiday, such as the 4th of July?
Not in the current charter, no.
It's language that is proposed but not adopted.
So am I hearing that we have leeway on this?
I think we do, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So if it's agreeable with everybody, then you can cross the 4th of July off as far as coming to the assembly is concerned. But is there any other business that anybody wishes?
You're going to mention Selectman's meeting, the meeting Friday? It's a meeting Friday of the Barnstable County Selectmen and Councilors Association. I think it's at the golf course in Hyannis?
Yes, it's this time it is at the Hyannis golf course. And it is the legislators.
Friday.
It's
association.
It's the legislators that are coming to present to the selectmen and councilors. And you're all welcome. It's 7:30. at the Hyannis Golf Course. And if you're coming, you must remember that there is construction, I'm sure many of you know, on the road there, so, and it will be a busy time with people going to work, so judge your time appropriately, and I hope to see you there. If there's no further business, oh, yes, Richard?
Yes, the last month we asked for some information on that cable advisory stuff. Have you been able to assemble that yet?
You've caught me. I'm sorry.
Caught you flat-footed.
You did.
It was in regards to, in the budget, there was something for the countywide negotiations for the cable contracts or something like that.
Okay. I haven't done anything, okay. But I will. Right. I will, yes.
Okay.
Thank you for bringing that to my attention.
Information from the Mass Municipal Association, there is legislation up there to change the way to have a statewide contract rather than individual municipal contracts or aggregate contracts that we go under now, for instance, Barnstable County aggregates. I think that's probably what Richard Anderson is referring to. And from what I understand, it's imminent. So I have some information, I think, on email and stuff. I'll send it to you and some written information.
Would you share it with them? Could you share it with all of us so we know?
Yeah, I'll see if I can get a chance.
All right. And I will check with Mark about it. Thank you. Any other business?
Madam Speaker.
No, we got
the Provincetown Portuguese Festival begins on Friday, June 22nd of this year. There the evening of the 22nd and the 23rd, there's music and public dancing in the center of town adjacent to the town hall on Ryder Street. It's all been refitted with new electronic equipment and electrical equipment, so it should be even better than it always has been.
Good.
And it continues through Sunday when the blessing of the fleet takes place. It's Provincetown's big celebration. My prediction is in about 20 years there'll be a Provincetown Portuguese-Jamaican-Eastern European festival, because the people from those countries are now maritally integrating with people in Provincetown. So I look forward to that if I live to be
good. Thank you.
Old
Fred,
enough.
Do you have something?
Be good food, I'm sure.
Thank you, George.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. You know, John brought up this flex schedule and the fact that there is no county identification. And we have had, over the last 3 years that I've been here, a number of conversations where we have said that every piece of material that's produced about a county program should have, or funding partially made by the county, should have a county logo on it. We all know that one of the major problems that this assembly and the county faces is the lack of public relations, the lack of awareness of what the county does for people. So this is another example. Diane, is there a way of making a note from us to the county that we really should take that seriously? I felt that they started talking about the flex service as opposed to this problem of identity,
we can certainly make a note to them that we feel that the logo should go on this. I think Lance says, that it's all right, but we can do something about it. But I mean, we can't do it now, but the next time they print a schedule, I'll encourage them to put the county logo on there. Okay.
It's very important.
All right.
Thanks.
We're going to lose Steve. Okay. So if there's no further
Madam
business.
Madam Speaker, I move we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you very much.